video which we are doing at Jobs for Her is the expert live chat, and the topic that we are going to be talking about is using technology to collaborate with and to lead online. So a lot of you have asked very interesting questions, and before I start answering each of those, I would like to kind of make you all understand a few of the important things when it comes to leading with technology and collaborating using technology. So that itself has been pointed out through the questions. Brilliant work at Jobs for Her Women in Achievers Women Achievers Group. So one of the things that this covers is the virtual meetings part, which is how are the virtual meetings going to be effective, and how the virtual meetings can be streamlined and made more productive and less complex. So that's one way of looking at it. The second is the reports, the progress reports, or the kind of accountability from the different members of the team, and to see if the work is being done or not. The third important aspect is work from home being the new normal, because we don't know how long this lockdown is going to continue and which when normalcy will set in. So till then, we have to assume that this is the new normal that we all have to work with. The next is the virtual hiring, which is from the HR perspective, that how can the right recruiting be done, the right talent management, and all those techniques and ideas and trainings be handled effectively online. The other thing is leading team online when it comes to one-to-one, having a relationship with your team members, as well as the collective team, the collective group, the collective company, the different departments, at the same time, having a the wholesome approach of taking everyone together and making sure everyone is also well informed, well connected, yet everybody's doing their work properly. Another aspect is the work from home negative side, because a lot of people are not used to the work from home culture and the work from home environment, and then it's easy to get bored. It's easy to get very, very tired, or maybe if you're working on your bed, or if you're working just to feel uncomfortable on your couch or something, then you might start feeling sleepy and you might doze off. These are some of the things that people are sharing that they're going through. And another aspect of this is about the complexity that arises. I think a lot of times this is going to apply to a lot of people, that how complex can it get, working with so much of data and so much of accountability, and not everyone is used to it, because it was easy to just walk in and just check with people if everybody is doing their work, and then have people who are taking care of different things. But here everything has turned, and there's a lot of screen time for all of us. So now screen time has become work as well as entertainment, as well as staying in touch with relationships and people who are not close to you. So everything has become screen time, and it's kind of taxing on your eyes, it's taxing on your body, it's taxing on your neck, on your shoulders, a lot of different things. So let's go through each of the questions that everybody has asked. I'll start with Veda. So Veda asks, "Hi, having virtual meetings with my team members isn't producing the result I wished for. Can it be improved?" Yes, definitely, Veda. The ways to improve it is, let me help you understand a few things. One very important thing to understand when it comes to virtual meetings is the platform and how comfortable your team members are with a certain platform. Now, what I mean here in when I say comfortable means, one of the things can be how comfortable they are in terms of navigating through the platform, as in whether they know how to download, do they need to download it, or can they join from a browser. So joining from a browser is a good idea, if not everybody wants to download the apps. Unless you are using an app for a very long time and you feel it's going to be used again and again, so it's a good idea then to kind of make everyone ready with the apps, download it and keep it ready. Otherwise, the other way to look at it, when I say be comfortable with the platform, is the internet connection. Because when they were all in the office, or they all had access to a physical environment where all the infrastructure was provided by the system or the company, it was easier, they could not blame anybody else, and there weren't many things to worry about because everybody got the same connection, more or less. But when it comes to work from home, different people can have different connections, and area-wise, even if they get the best connection, some areas are not very viable, and they don't have a proper connection at a certain time of the day or generally throughout. So there has to be a way to work around it, what kind of platform is being used, and whether it is going to take a lot of internet bandwidth, or is it going to be okay with even low connectivity and low Wi-Fi connection. So that's the first way to look at it, the platform. The second is the agenda. So when it comes to virtual meetings, physical meetings, when you are seeing people, when you are making out, physical, there's a physical touch to the entire meeting, the formal meetings, it's easier because, you are seeing people, you're moving around, a lot of that. But when it comes to an online meeting, there are certain restrictions where people cannot necessarily, go out and, mix with people. If they get tired, they cannot move around. They cannot be having their phone and, moving around like this. It's very disturbing for the other people to see. So what happens here is that the agenda cannot be very long. It has to be very crisp. Now, again, when it's very crisp, it has to be action-oriented. Instead of having very long meetings at one time, it's important that the meetings be broken down little by little. The agenda needs to be broken down in such a way that for some time people are having a screen time and then they're going back to working on something. Then again, maybe next day or a few days later, have another meeting and work on it. The reason I'm suggesting this is because, as I said, if the meeting is also virtual, the work is also virtual, it gets a little taxing, for team members to kind of focus, concentrate, and give their best. So they might think that meeting you just need to hear through because you don't have much to say or much to kind of contribute. Best is go back to work again. So just listen through and somehow, go through that meeting time. So that will not be a productive meeting. But if people know that yes, it's going to be like a short meeting, everybody is going to be listening, everybody is going to be attending, everybody can have a say, and then maybe, everybody can go back to work. I think it makes things very, very easy because people will know that. They see when it comes to office, what happens? People are using laptop and technology even then, but they have a physical slap and then a digital and then physical digital alternate, right? Here there is no alternate. It's the same thing. Everything is digital. The meeting is also digital. The work is also digital. So we have to understand that when we plan meetings, the agenda has to be such that people get that time to fluctuate, to kind of see that, okay, a little bit of time of meeting gone, take a rest, take a break, something, and then go back to work. So their priority will always be work. Their priority will not be meeting so much unless they really have something like to really clearly understand how to do something. But generally, people like to, and the common excuse that people can give if they're not interested in a meeting is that the internet was not working or the bandwidth was low or the video is not visible. Because see, this is what happens in every sector now. And the reason we have to make our meetings productive, we have to make our services and products very, very solid and with a clear foundation of what we are offering to people. Now, we cannot fool people. We cannot expect people to just understand us and somehow buy it. Now, everybody is going for quality. Same thing, when we're having a meeting, again, if it's not a quality meeting, if people are not getting and giving back something, if it's not motivating enough, the chances are people will make an excuse and say that, okay, you know what, I'm not interested. Because in a physical meeting, you can drag people, you can see that they are there. But there is no guarantee, that can be done and that can happen, in case of the digital meetings. Because people, as I said, very well can say that, things are not working, internet is not working. And you can't question, even if you ask for a screenshot, there are ways that it can actually be weak if they're using a hotspot versus a Wi-Fi versus the areas that they are using. So if people are not interested, excuses are easy to give, which is why we need to make our meetings productive. Now, one very important thing when it comes to a digital meeting or virtual meeting is this, that people need to be given a chance to be, heard. So let's say there are 7 people in the meeting, or let's say 20 people, or let's say 50 people in the meeting. Depending on the number, it may not be easy to kind of engage everybody. Now, one way to do it is, as I said, if even for the agenda, break it down. Now, according to the agenda breaking down, you may need lesser number of people for a particular thing. So just engage those people, fewer number, let everybody voice out something that they are worried about, that they have an opinion on. In case you can't hear each one of them, encourage them to use the chat so that, they are at least voicing out what they're thinking, whatever is going on in their mind, they're able to share it. If required, another way to do it is there are some tools online where you have one particular like website which has a lot of to-dos. So it's like small like slips are there, like it's like small different colored pieces of paper kind of thing is there on the screen, and everybody who can log on and has that particular link which you as a team leader will share with them, they can scribble their own notes on that particular color that that is assigned to them, or they can write their name and the others know that I cannot write on this particular color. So I'll share these resources if you ask me the questions in the group. So this is one way, have a particular platform where everybody can, type in their messages. Also, if you're on Zoom, for instance, You can use the screen sharing and give everybody the control to start typing. So maybe if it's a small number, then they can all type on different areas of the screen, maybe using different colors, so that you know that, everybody's opinion is there on the page. And when people see that, their voice and their opinion and things are heard, they feel encouraged to participate more and turn up better and stay engaged and contribute better, and then follow up even if they see that, there is an engagement from their side that's happening and they are being heard. Now, the other thing is follow up. I think one very important aspect here is that when we speak of follow up, I think it's easier to have a meeting and then say that, I'm going to get this done. But follow up is difficult. Now, at times, it happens that because of network issues, you can't get back to people because of, certain things has to be downloaded, certain apps have to be accessed. And therefore, this has happened with me where I have, informed certain members of the team I would be doing this, but because of technology glitch or the internet connection, that website is kind of crashing or it's not processing further. So I feel scared to kind of, and if it's something to do with a financial transaction, even more like, kind of you don't feel sure if you want to kind of take that risk. So this is one of the things. But if it's not financial, you can take a screenshot maybe if you're not able to share the link. Another very important tool, especially, in this COVID situation, is that a lot of times, people can't be on emails throughout the day. They're trying to even take out time for themselves. They're wanting to take out time for, work, for family, a lot of different things. So one good practice is that, you kind of shoot an email, but at the same time, you follow up on a WhatsApp group. So have a WhatsApp group and just inform them that an email has been sent and give them, certain deadlines which are not too rigid. But then, they can get back to you in that period of time. So then follow-up becomes easy because maybe, again, as I said, because of internet connection or something or the other, the person cannot get back immediately like they would have if they were in a physical setup. So chances are, there will be a delay in things. But keep a 24-hour window. I think that's one of the best practices that I have learned from working at Life Bushido, which is a US-based company. And the virtual company that I worked for taught me a lot of good practices. And this is one of them, that you have a 24-hour, kind of, you have to revert back in revert in 24 hours, not more than that. So whether you are a team member, whether you are somebody else, you have to get back within 24 hours. That should be the practice during the lockdown period as well. Minutes of the meeting. I think, as I said, the agenda needs to be crisp, but at the same time, chances are that maybe on one hand, people can be too excited and engaged, and therefore they're contributing very well. On the other hand, it can be reversed that they are not so engaged. So if they are engaged, you may not be able to kind of cover exactly what you thought. Maybe it'll go beyond what you expected. It'll be better. Or it can be, people are not so engaged. There was a technical problem or something or the other, internet issues on your side, their side. So chances are, what you planned is not happening. So minutes of the meeting becomes very important. Again, you can't be the one writing, like, the minutes of the meeting if you're leading it, because you should be focusing as a team leader on what everybody else, is doing and how they're doing it and all of that. Whereas you put one team member who you know will be engaged, for safer option, have two people, let them know that in case one of them is not able to do it, he or she needs to inform the other person, or let both of them do it, or divide it into half and let them compile together and get back to you. Because the reason I'm saying this, typically it's okay, it's not about capability that you can write the full minutes together and one person doing it. It's about the social exchange that becomes possible if you are, two people and then you're just exchanging something, sending the notes over. And preferably, if you're going to do digital, it's best if you have like a WhatsApp and then, you're typing it there and sending it in the group or to each other. Because then, the other person just has to edit little bit, copy paste and put it in a document or email or whatever it is. So it becomes easier, to kind of get back to make things smoother and faster for everybody. So this was about virtual meetings. Now the second question is about, so Manasa says, during lockdown, most of the companies have preferred work from home. How can our team be functional in an efficient way? Very good question. When we say, functional and efficient, what comes to my mind is the roles and the responsibilities being clear. A lot of times what happens is in physical structure, you can kind of say that, okay, my senior will do it, my junior will do it. Usually juniors are supposed to do if a senior cannot do it or if he's busy with something. So, I mean, if it comes to blame, then it becomes easier for a, I mean, that's typically the structure we've seen. But now it's time to change all that, negativity and to stop the blame game. And take it upon yourself that how can you be more clear on your roles and responsibilities? One important practice here is, let's say you have a project. Now, when you break it down, don't shoot out a long email saying that this is your role, this is the role of this person, that person, this is the timeline. No. It's best if you have an Excel sheet maybe or a table form where you are writing the name of the person, the role and responsibility and the deadline, and break down that role into more, you know, the role is there and then responsibilities maybe and the tasks broken down into smaller things, and then, you know, timeline assigned accordingly so that people don't get overwhelmed. Maybe it's a good idea to even get in touch with the person, let them know that what their role is going to be, and ask them instead, you know, have that social angle to it where you ask them, what do you think, you know, the timeline required is for this particular task? How do you want to break it down? Do you want to do this first or do you want to do that first? Why I'm saying this is, it's an important thing, you know, when you're including a social angle with more and more digital environment that we're trying to build. You know, again, have focused meetings. Put 15, 20 minutes aside for this person. Be very clear on the three questions that you want to ask this person. 5 minutes roughly. Reduce your talking time. Let the other person share more. If they get stuck, don't give away answers. Let them come up with inputs. Ask them more questions. And not in a way to kind of assess if they're smart enough to be the person in your company. It's more about, you know, letting them feel comfortable enough to voice out what they're thinking loudly. Brainstorm with them, let them take initiative, because trust me, if people come up with, you know, what they should be doing, how they should be doing, and their inputs are taken, work gets done faster, because then, you know, there is a touch of self into that. So let's say, you know, typically if you sent out a table saying this should be the first, second, third task, the other person would get very, very bored. Yes, you can suggest in case, you know, it's a project that the other person does not have too much awareness of, or they're not so experienced, chances are that, you know, the other person will feel, okay, it's too overwhelming. I don't know if this is to be done this way or that way. Give them options. Make them think, do you think this will help you kind of go to the next step better? Or do you think this will be better? Ask them questions. When you ask them questions, them, you know, when the team feels that you are giving them that, you know, freedom to be themselves, to voice out, then they will take accountability on behalf of your company and you. They will feel that, yes, their voices are heard, their opinions matter. And therefore, you know, what we want as a team leader, that the team takes accountability, feels for us, you know, takes opinion, takes initiatives for us. They will do that when their voices are heard and when we ask them what is their natural style of work. Of course, you know, as a company, you might have certain ideas and certain plans and certain missions and certain timelines and deadlines to meet. But very important thing is, like, you have to include them. The more you include them, the faster the work will be done and smoother and more properly. And they'll come back to you, you know, instead of making big mess and disasters and mistakes and then, you know, having to fix all of those errors or give somebody else to fix the errors. That will be reduced big time because you are inculcating everything, you know, that you've heard from the other person in whatever way possible. Now, the email length. Now, what happens is, you know, typically if you shoot out an email, you know, it has an attachment or it has a link to something, or it is, you know, having an attachment maybe on Google Drive of a particular document and a template, alongside that. But one very important practice that I have understood during this lockdown period is that your team cannot be completely, you know, hooked on like raw of data. Because as I said, you know, it's exhausting. Trust me, you know. Even if I'm someone who's a content creator and someone into a lot of content all the time, be it speaking, writing, researching, training, all of that. But what I have learned from my own practice is that you need to make your emails kind of average or shorter, but you can follow up on the WhatsApp. So a lot of people have access to WhatsApp. Now, a lot of misunderstandings or clarity, like, you know, there's misconception or miscommunication if there is a lot of email, and maybe, you know, it depends from person to person. See, there are two ways of communication here that I want to point out when it comes to digital communication. Some of us are great with professional communication. We know what words to put, how to put it, and all of that. And there's another communication style which is very connecting. You know how to talk to whom in a way that makes the other person feel connected and comfortable. Now, these two styles, you don't know, in your team, you'll have, let's say, 15 people or 20 people or 50 people. Not everybody will have the same type of style. It will vary. So a good practice here is during this lockdown is that you make sure that you write an email, you send it out like a professional email, then follow up on WhatsApp with a brief like of the same. Maybe have a voice note, so there's a personal touch from your side, a quick brief one, less than a minute, less than 2 minutes, at the most three, not more than that, where you kind of clarify what you're expecting people to kind of work on and what to understand. If they have questions, answer those queries briefly on the WhatsApp. Instead of making one long voice note, have shorter voice notes so that people can, listen, download quickly, delete if it's not required for them. And they all feel heard when you are giving separate voice notes as separate clarity to everybody. If it's instruction from your side, you can have a full 3 minutes, maximum. But if you kind of want to answer people's questions, then it's best to make them feel personalized and go back to each one separately and a shorter note, that they can only listen to what they want. If they want to listen to somebody else's, they can do that. So there's a personal touch to the digital part. Now, time fixed to revert. As I said, the 24-hour window is very, very effective if you kind of want people to get back. If it's very, very urgent, give them a few hours to work on it. Maybe if you feel that these people are used to staying awake at night, then send them at night so that, they can revert back by the day and work on it at night. Or if you feel that, but that's a bad practice, honestly, to make people awake and do their work. If they're motivated and driven, they will do it. But to expect it is bad because they might want to rest, they might want to relax, and they might want have other plans and schedules for the day. And if supposing you want to do it during the day, then expect it, to be somewhat done by a little later in the night. So like 9, 9:30, So timings will change. So if you want that, your work timing should vary, then instead of having that same flexibility, I mean the rigidity of work hours, say 9 to 7 or 9 to 6 or 9 to 2 or 10 to 5 or whatever, it's best if you give them blocks, time blocks. So let's say 10 to 1, they're supposed to work on something, get back, give them 1, 1.5 hour break, let them start working. Ask your team members, your employees, what are their preferences. You can have flexibility. If it requires collaboration between different people, then you need to have the same blocks of time between people. But if you feel that yes, they are going to be working independently, very well, go ahead and let them have different, time blocks assigned. So let's say, one team prefers to work from 10 to 1, or maybe some are early risers. So they want to start, let's say, from 9, 9 to 12. Then give them a break of 1 hour, and then, make it super focused again from 2 to, let's say, 5 or 6. And then, give a 1 hour break and then 2 hours of work. Or 1 hour of work. Decide and ask people for preferences. Somebody might want to work at a stretch and get off early. That's again their choice. Give them choice so that your work gets done on time and properly. The next question is, Priyanka says, "Hi, ma'am. How can I make work from home the new normal using technology?" Very good question, Priyanka. Because when we say that it's the new normal, it's like the situation we can perceive in the next 3 months at least, for most cases, or even longer. We don't know how long this is going to stretch, because even if so, depending again on the sector you're working on, or the kind of roles and responsibilities that you have, or how seriously the company is taking, and if it's possible for the company to operate digitally, that's another question. So I mean, depending on whatever it is, you have to understand that when we say that work from home is the new normal, we need to understand, that there has to be an environment that we create to make work from home the new normal. So we can't have a very, very rigid, environment and fix. So I'll give you an example from my own life. So when I do work from home, I have various kind of things that I do. So I sometimes have international meetings in Germany, US, UK, all of this, which requires a lot of, engagement outside my country. So the work hours and the timings are pretty late at times and early morning at times. So then I prefer to kind of sit up, otherwise I'll go to sleep. Literally, that's the case. Or, at times it's best if I have a very long, and a chat or something. I even don't mind sitting on the ground with a table in front of me and, having a clean, plain background and feeling comfortable. My legs are kind of relaxed. Or, if it's like, it requires a lot of attentiveness, where you have to engage with people, listen to them, respond back on time, all of that, then it's a good idea to sit on a chair. That's about the furniture part of it. Avoid the bed at all times, because the more you are around the bed, you are going to be more likely to kind of feel sleepy and drowsy, and kind of that comfort thing will make you want to go back and relax often, which will reduce the productivity. What you can do is give yourself that pleasure and reward that once you are done with this much of work hours in a particular space, you can go back to your bed, relax, and then come back. I mean, listen to music while lying down or something or the other like that. So that'll be like a great, kind of self-reward, self-motivation techniques that I personally adopt. Now, when it comes to the area, so I said about area meaning the furniture, prefer your own room. If you're sharing the room, even then, work it out with whoever your either teammate is or your partner is or your siblings are or whatever, like whoever you're sharing room with. Or if you're alone, nothing like it, you have your room to yourself. If you feel there's noise in a space which you're sharing with other people, have a mutual understanding that, if it requires you to be talking and using a lot of technology to interact, then you need less of background noise. But also, when you are working, you need some peaceful time. So have, if the other person is also working, have, alternate thing and adjustment that when I have this talking time, you'll have this peace time. So this way you kind of even have a good social angle when you're working digitally and you're working to build relationships at the same time. Now the setting. This was about area, infrastructure, all of that. Now when it comes to setting, avoid balcony, by the way, veranda, balcanies, because they have a lot of noise. Yes, if you need like a fresh if you need fresh air and at the same time you have a lot of work piled up, then it's a good idea to work for some time over there and come back and maybe plug your phone so that you get the breeze and you have some focused time of listening to something and working without getting distracted. So that's one of the ways when we are saying area wise. Then setting. What I mean by setting is have a professional setting where, let's say, as I said, table chair or something to the laptop or something which makes you aware and serious. Have checkpoints to ensure you're working and you're accountable. So one of the things that I personally do is that I've started doing even more recently. I earlier had a diary, where I was writing down what I had to do this time slot, that time slot. But now what I have done is, and I'll show you all through the app that I have downloaded. It's called Google Calendar, and it's worked wonderfully for me because what I've realized is that you have your time blocks more clear. So I'll quickly show you how my time blocks work. And this is like a week which I have. So if you see this, you can't make out clearly, but you can see relatively how this works. I have the days and times allotted. I have certain things which are fixed on certain days. You'll see some breaks in between. You'll see yellow blocks which are like for dinner, lunch, prayer, all of that. And then there are different, if something is being repeated, if I have to do something, with the same kind of work, same kind of people, I have different colors which are assigned to it. And then if you see some spaces, I've kept some space aside so that if sudden work comes up, if there's an emergency or something, then I have like enough time to, kind of go back to that. So Google Calendar has the month option on the top, as you can see. Let me show you the other thing that really works. So if you see on the top, this line which is there, you have the day option, you have the week option, the month option. You now can go on the day option and, kind of see, if your work is enough, like a lot for a day, or you can make it smaller and bigger accordingly. If you want to do 3 days at a time, 3 days will pop up like that. And you can schedule it. So the plus sign that you see here is good, to kind of event schedule an event, as you can see. So goal, reminder, and event. When you schedule an event, you have things popping up here. So events, if you have an email which is synced, it'll show up here what time to what time. If you want certain things to be repeated, you need to customize it here. When you customize it here, you'll be able to, yes, you're giving them access to location. So let's say you want every Sunday, Tuesday, Friday, something, and then you do done. So you'll see that there is a particular option that'll happen. So repeats, see, repeats weekly on Sunday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday. And once you do save, it really helps because once you are kind of, saving up something, what happens is, you have like constant reminders that pop up. So on my thing, it keeps popping up on the top. Like supposing what do I have to do next? On the top, it'll keep popping up. So today at this time, this is going to happen. What helps me here is supposing if I have like a lot scheduled for the day, it makes my work easy if I have a calendar, which is kind of a to-do list, also a reminder. If I want to add some documents, I can even have space for that in that Google Calendar. And I can always refer that for this particular class or this particular meeting or this particular session, I need to refer to this particular thing. And it's very, very easy because I don't forget. I get 30 minutes before reminder. So while I'm in something, I get a reminder that you can't forget this. So I don't need a personal assistant. I don't need too much of, that exhaustion that, oh my God, I forgot this and I forgot that. So this is one practice which has helped me tremendously in the last few days. And I realized that I needed to use my Google for Education training here to make my own work easier. And it's worked wonders because I'm able to multitask, I'm able to do a lot of things. I'm not missing, most of my deadlines unless it's a technology glitch or Wi-Fi connection related problems. But most of it is coming, on my phone, including the reminder to sleep, which I've put that between 11 and 11:30, I need to sleep. So that I succeeded 1 or 2 days. The next few days, again, when the reminder came, I just put 30 minutes late. But that reminder helped me to stay on track as much as possible. So this is something I would encourage you to do it as well. Have a lot of blocks, that helps. Or, have a calendar where again your blocks are clear, you have break periods, you have food time, all of that kind of chalked out. And like as I said, I am involved with like a lot of international, national and local stuff. So my time is like kind of too hard. But now I've started relaxing a little bit because now I know how to work around my schedule. I've got a grip on my schedule rather than the schedule controlling me all the time and me being exhausted and not knowing how to kind of, work around the hectic schedule and the long, duration of things that I need to do. Now, the next question is by, so yeah, the setting part, the important things I already told you, how to have a Google Calendar and to have all your things clear, have color codes, which will make things more clear that this and this is repeated in so many days. So I have like between this and this 2 days time. So, you can plan and schedule accordingly and keep your things ready. Now, the next one is Preeti. As an HR, I want to know if hiring the right people is possible through virtual hiring. Preeti, I want to share an example here with you. So it was like 3, 4 years back, I think longer, when I was part of an organization where we recruited through Let's Intern and Internshala. So these are two websites where we wanted interns for some work, which was website development. And we got hold and we set aside, whatever our requirements were and whatever we were willing to offer in return. And you won't believe the person who joined me that time. So I was the one who took the interview for the first time. My team, I did not know if they were very happy or not very happy, but he didn't stay long in that company after I left. Even it seemed he left. And then I stayed connected to him. He stayed connected to me. And he's like a brother to me now. And he's become like, the person who I can trust. He's been with me before the inception of both my companies, and he's been the most long, like the oldest member of the team, though he's the youngest. And it's wonderful, how he kind of is engaged, involved in everything that I do. The reason, I'll tell you what helped, because I focused on his strength. His one of his weaknesses was the language. He was not very confident with the Hindi language. Like, so he was not very confident with English. Hindi was something he was good at. But otherwise, he was a very skilled guy, and I understood that while talking to him. And because I had a very personal conversation to understand his background and where he was coming from, and I very openly asked that I was asking you questions in English, and why did you answer in Hindi, something along those lines. And his answer, which was honest, impressed me. So I think, that paid off. I was honest in my approach to somebody, who I had not met, who I didn't know. But at the same time, I think, I trusted, I asked the right questions, I gave myself time, I gave him time. And eventually, we've started trusting each other so much that today he handles all my accounts. At times, he makes payments on my behalf, and then I kind of pay him back. And he won't even tell me that a payment needs to be made for the online, whatever subscription or whatever website work has been done. So what I'm trying to say is I found one of the most important people in my core team, which is like the member for the same role across 2, 3 companies now, which are all 3 of mine. And I've realized that how important this person has become, and this person was recruited online. So what helped was the honest question and answers that happened, my honesty in asking him whatever I thought of him and his journey, and then being able to cross-check. So I went back to if a person is giving you references of contacting another person to see if this person is credible or not. Or at times, his work is apparent and visible, and whatever he's shared and he's like is all there up on with a digital footprint. These are some of the things that help to connect and trust people online. Another very important thing when it comes to HR and meeting people for different roles in the company or for recruiting or for talent management. Some of my best relationships, at work, at life, at personal and for professional level, have been, the people I've trusted the most and the people I've become like, I trust blindly are the people who I have met digitally. Now, the reason I say that is because I didn't rush things. I didn't do it for the sake of it. I realized, that in spite of not meeting some of the people who I'm working with across the world, I've realized I can trust them because we took time, we asked each other honest questions, we opened up about our vulnerabilities, our problems. So when you ask a person again, when it this is something personal slash professional that I'm talking of, but here when it comes to exclusively professional, I would encourage you to bring a personal angle to it, have a video conference, have a call, telephonic conversation. And by the way, these people who I spoke to initially, who I have the like the who are part of my core team in life and at work, these are people who I didn't have a video call with. I had a telephonic conversation with, but they were frequent, they were very honest, and whatever it was, we were kind of vocal about whatever we felt, whether it was a negative, positive emotion. So when it comes to work also, I think you need to understand the other person's where that person is coming from, what background the other person is coming from. So at times, you may be surprised as to who becomes part of your team. You expected something, but it turns out to be something else. Chances are at times, even after, I've seen this, after a physical interaction with people and then, recruiting them, I have not been very happy with that. But at times, a digital thing can pay off, vice versa. I mean, digital thing might be a bad experience for you, a physical one might be a good one. So it's best that, I know people say that there are a lot of frauds and there are a lot of, fake things that are there online and people can fool you. A good practice is check out their LinkedIn, check out, a little bit, give their take their resume if you have a city, contact in that particular city. If they're not from your city, have a local background check. Is this place near this place? Do you think these kind of people live there? Maybe the exact, inquiry cannot be done, but more or less, are students living in these apartments mostly, or are professionals, things like that. And then cross-check with the other person in a different way to understand that, oh wow, I heard about this place from a friend and he was telling me or she was telling me. So cross-check in a way that the other person feels that you've made an inquiry, but not in a negative way, but very honestly, you had to do it. So when you're vocal and, kind of honest about whatever it is, you make the right choices in terms of the people that you work with and who work with you. So don't be scared, don't be like, don't freak out thinking, oh my God, what platforms? I would say Jobs for Her has a good, kind of workforce, and the kind of women who come here, very, very talented. There's a good streaming mechanism of, kind of filtering people and then putting them into right kind of categories for work. I think Jobs for Her is one of the portals you can look up when you're thinking of recruiting people for online work. If you're looking for more options, you can also go for Let's Intern, Internshala. I'm not too happy with the feedback I've got from Naukri and the others, but yeah, I mean Freshers, Shine and whatnot. But I think Let's Intern and Internshala has given me some good kind of people to contact and to get back. So I think I would recommend that based on my experience, and Jobs for Her, of course, because I've met some amazing people on this platform, and the people that I check out and hear about, it's amazing, what people are doing here. So this is one source and, community where you can go back and check out. And plus, you have different groups. So if you have a different requirement, women in HR, you're looking for somebody who's more into HR and talent and all, you can look up people from there and have a pool of women who you want to kind of interview and then go through. And then, have some recommendation, reference, or some kind of source of trust when you're recruiting. Because digitally, it's already a little like little complex in the sense that you can't trust people easily. You've not worked with people. But yeah, I mean, it helps if you have some reference point. Things can still go wrong, but you at least have done some, background work and homework. The next one is from Priyanka. Yes, this is done. Janet, how to keep check on my team's weekly re work reports online? Good question, Janet, because when we speak of, having reports, I think one of the things we are all going to be struggling with in the next few days, if we are not already struggling, is the amount of data to go through if you're expecting reports. Also, the accuracy of the reports, because a lot of times, we just feel, okay, this basic thing is done. We've glanced through it. It looks okay. But then later on, if something happens, you'll be like, oh God, I missed it. So then the blame game starts. Okay, this person didn't send it across. I had, everybody doesn't want to take the blame. So one of the good practices here is that when we speak of, the report part and to go through data, which is a lot of data, either have the team, delegated, like, have a delegation of role. So let's say if the weekly report is kind of a very detailed one, then have certain part assigned and certain part that people are going through. So one person, is assigned for so many reports that they have to go through only this part. The other person, based on their expertise and, work and all that you've assigned them, they'll go through the other part of the report. Or they get, some reports, the other person gets some reports. So that way, workload is reduced, but the quality and checking is done properly. And then general comments and remarks are made on the reports and sent to you as a team lead. And then you can kind of, filter through and see, if there are more questions that you want to ask. So whether you want to go back and ask the person directly who submitted the report or the person who's gone through the report for you. So it's up to you how you want to have that, hierarchy set. Also, don't make it very, very long, as I said. Break it down into, just like I suggested, the roles part. Also break it down in terms of the reports part, so that you ensure that this much work is done properly, then you go to the next part. What you can also do is, if you feel that templates help people stay on track, at the same time, have reports which you can keep slightly flexible, so that they can, have their freedom to in have more inputs, have more criteria, but not too much. Have a deadline. I mean, a set, kind of fixed thing. That supposing if there are six things that you're looking at, four things are fixed from your side, two things they can add on their own, not everything. The total six things, four things are going to be more or less the same or along certain criteria, whereas the rest is kind of like where they have their say and they can have their inputs into that. So that's about the complexity part. Then Preeti says, or Preeti's done, Mary asks, I have been a team lead for the past 2 years. I want to connect with my team members. This being my first time leading online, how do I do so effectively using tech? Now, my points here is like two important things that you need to understand here when you speak of leading online is the one-to-one relationship that you have and the connection that you have with your team and your company and the people in your company, and second, the group connection that you have. So when I say one-to-one, so let's say you're in charge of a team and you have to keep in touch with everybody one-to-one so that they feel that the social touch is there with you and they're accountable to you at the end of the day. There's some personal touch with the directly the leader. That makes a lot of difference to people when they feel that the leader is directly approachable and connected to the people. Second, very important thing to understand here is when it comes to collective, is this collective based on projects? So different kind of departments are coming together for one project, or is it department wise? So different departments are set aside. Now you need to figure out how and in what way are you leading? Are you leading across teams, across departments, or are you leading a single department and not a complete project? Or I mean, it depends on you. So I'm just kind of keeping it open. I'll give you some general ideas and techniques and practices. So when it comes to relationship, as I said, it's very important to have one-to-one relation beside the full relation. I know teams can be really big and difficult to manage, but what I'm saying is at least at 5 minutes of touch, feedback, let's say maximum, where you pick up the phone and or send a voice note or a quick email saying, hey, you know what? A voice note helps, in this lockdown period when you don't have too much of social interaction, where you say, hey, you know what? I think, it's like what you've done is really, commendable. This part especially, I'm so happy to see you doing this. But I also think, if you work on this a little more, it'll make a great difference, I'm sure, and it'll like really make you shine. So, I mean, if you say like that, and send out a quick note, it really matters to people, that you've taken out that time, a quick feedback, and they've, saved it, and they have something to hear when they feel down or demotivated. So this is like this is called radical candor, where you have like a suggestion, where you have like a feedback, which is a positive appreciation feedback, followed by a little bit of, into challenging the other person in a positive way and helping them improve and, look at how they can make it better. So that's one way to do it, the voice note part. When it comes to the collective team, as I said, have very clear roles and responsibilities of what everybody is going to be doing in the team. Break it down into smaller tasks so that everybody has their clear deadline and clear roles and tasks aside. Also, let their voices be heard. So when you are a team leader, I think, if you can independently ask them to send you a personal message or, send out a form and they can, kind of get back to you with a quick, short answer or to whatever questions you want to ask. Or some broad ideas you want them to share. I mean, whichever way you want a form, a Google form or a survey form to be sent out, or you want a direct, you send out the question in the WhatsApp group, individual messages come to you. Or if you have an email and then you send out a common question to everybody, but you tell them that they can individually send you the reply and or and one more person maybe and CC them so that you have like that personal thing with them and their voices are heard. Now the next question is, Zaina says, many of my employees aren't feeling motivated as they are stuck at home and it's driving them insane. Are there some technological tools to help them or engage with a non-work activity? I love this question because it's a very honest one, which I just shared before, that as a leader, you have to be honest. Now, the negative side of work from home is what I'm going to briefly touch upon here. Motivation is very difficult. But then if you have a proper, as I said, environment, setting, all of that, you don't need the most beautiful and comfortable things. But yes, you need to have a more structured and kind of balanced, way of going about things. As I said, different tips which can help. Now, non-work activities can be, you can put everybody on a game online, like Kahoot is there, or there can be others which you can use, and people can be engaging and online at the same time and beat each other. Or if they are, game alcoholics, I mean, gameaholics. So they would be like, people who kind of really enjoy games, and then, you can have a separate entertainment time for them. And on the other hand, you can be having like, some kind of maybe, racing or some submission online, or a quiz that they can quickly take, or, they can all be drawing things and, in some time, send it to you. Now I'll quickly wrap up with the last thing, which says that team building activities are many. You can look at, which department you're working on, have parallel games alongside, or, something that people can be enjoying and, kind of also relaxing, but their work also gets done. If it's about logos, that have to be designed in a marketing team, send out five people, have to get back in this time. So a lot of things can be done. If you have more questions, please get back on the chat. I'll be more than happy to answer. Great session I felt, because I felt excited to share from my experiences, because the kind of questions that came were very, very honest questions from leadership that, is going through some challenges. I look forward to more expert chats with you and answering more questions. Thank you so much.